Tren Hard Eat Clen Anavar Give Up. For those not in the know, Tren is short for Trenbolone, Clen is short for Clenbuterol, and Anavar is, well, Anavar. All three of these are different performance-enhancing drugs, and this meme exemplifies the close relationship that exists between the gym and use of steroids. You know, the whole natty or not phenomena. Steroids have gone through transformation over the years, from being classified as being as dangerous as crack cocaine, to the acceptance of TRT, to the realization that a lot more people are using them than previously thought, usually associated with the dark side of the fitness industry. These illegal compounds are used by athletes to artificially increase their muscle growth, strength, lose fat, increase performance, and a flurry of other possible benefits. But as they say, nothing good is free. Along with increasing your performance, steroids can have a major negative effect on your body and could even result in death, right? There are a lot of misunderstandings and scare tactics that surround steroids. The problem is there is plenty of confusion concerning what steroids even are, largely thanks to information put out by the media. Let's remember that the media used to make outrageous claims about creatine, with some even suggesting it's a steroid. We're not saying steroids aren't dangerous, but we are saying that all of this confusion out there has painted steroids with a single brush. This video is going to help explain what steroids actually do. More importantly, what actually happens to your muscles if you take them? What better way to start this video than answering the most important question there is? What are steroids? This term has been largely abused by the general population and can refer to just about anything that's illegal and can increase performance. For example, the steroid EPO, or erythropoietin, is commonly used by athletes to improve performance and is the drug that Lance Armstrong was caught using. Erythropoietin is a hormone produced by the kidneys to increase the production of red blood cells. As a result, the body can deliver more oxygen to the muscle, increasing their work capacity. The only problem is it's not actually a steroid. It definitely falls under the umbrella term performance-enhancing drugs, or PEDs, but it's not technically a steroid. The same thing can be said about things like human growth hormone, a hormone that promotes growth of muscle and bone, or clenbuterol, the drug we mentioned in the intro, which is a powerful compound that acts similar to a powerful stimulant and thermogenic. These are routinely grouped together with steroids, but they are in fact not steroids. So what is a steroid? On a molecular level, a steroid is any of many organic compounds with a molecular structure containing four rings of carbon atoms. So by this definition, a steroid is a compound based on its structure. However, this includes things like vitamin D and cholesterol, which is not what people are talking about when they say steroid. They're talking about things like testosterone, a true steroid and also the most popular agent used by athletes to enhance their performance. Therefore, from now on, when we refer to steroids, we will be referring to a specific type of steroids that have a very specific function. These compounds are known as anabolic androgenic steroids, or AAS. AAS can include an array of different compounds, but they all mimic the natural steroid hormone, testosterone. This includes the synthetic testosterone, as well as compounds known as Trenbolone, Anavar, and a host of others. As these drugs all mimic testosterone, the best place to start this is by looking at what testosterone does. The natural hormone testosterone, that is, this can get confusing. Testosterone is the male's primary sex hormone and is produced in the testes of men, while women produce a small amount in their ovaries. When released throughout the body, they interact with what are known as androgen receptors to carry out its expression. Being the primary sex hormone, testosterone controls and enhances the development of male characteristics. In a male's life, their testosterone levels increase dramatically during puberty, which is one of the primary hormones responsible for things such as developing a deeper voice, facial hair, pubic hair, sex drive, increased sperm production, and libido. While these aren't the primary reasons people will use AAS, they do play a factor in, so keep these in mind as we go through the video. With that said, the primary reason men will take AAS is to increase their muscle strength and muscle size, either to improve aesthetics, performance, or both. The normal levels for men can vary widely. Physicians specializing in men's health consider anywhere from 300 to 1,000 nanograms per deciliter to be acceptable. To compare this to women, a woman's normal range for testosterone is 15 to 70 nanograms per deciliter. If we were to take the maximum acceptable range for women, the lowest range number for men's testosterone level is still more than 4 times higher. Regardless, even when looking at the testosterone levels found in men, there is a huge difference. A man at the higher range could have more than 3 times more than a man at the lower range. That's not far off from the difference between a woman's upper range and man's lower range. When it comes to athletic performance, level of testosterone is regarded as having the greatest influence. A general understanding is that greater levels of testosterone automatically means bigger muscles. However, it's a bit more complex than that. Research from 2018 tried to make some sense of this by measuring the hormone levels of 49 young trained men during 12 weeks of resistance training. What they found is very interesting. All of the men increased muscle mass. However, there was no relationship between the increase in muscle mass and level of testosterone. This just means that muscle growth was not directly influenced by level of testosterone. But the researchers did find this relationship somewhere else. The number of androgen receptors. Remember that androgen receptors are kind of like the telephone link between the muscle and testosterone and other AAS. AAS binds to these receptors to tell them what to do. In this case, grow. This simply suggests that a muscle having more androgen receptors results in more growth as it's triggered more. However, this doesn't mean that testosterone levels don't play any role. It does, and in a big way. Keep in mind that this study is comparing different people to each other. A person with more receptors will have greater potential for growth. However, if two people with the same amount of receptors had different amounts of testosterone levels, the one with higher levels would see more growth. It's similar to looking at cyclists. Some are beginners and some are elite. Some have heavy bikes and some have lightweight full carbon fiber bikes. An elite person on a heavy bike would still be able to beat a beginner on a full carbon. However, that doesn't mean the bike doesn't matter. If the same elite person were on a full carbon bike, they'd go even faster. Still, it's likely a combination of how many androgen receptors and circulating testosterone. In other words, having more androgen receptors won't mean much without high levels of testosterone. So now let's get into the effect of using AAS and what is actually occurring. First, let's further define AAS, anabolic androgenic steroids, by breaking down the name. Anabolic is the descriptive form of anabolism. Its most simple definition is a set of metabolic pathways that construct macromolecules like DNA or RNA from smaller units. That basically means tissue is built. Compare this to the opposite process, catabolism, which means the breakdown of tissue. Now let's look at the other word, androgenic. This is the adjective form of androgen. An androgen is any natural or synthetic hormone which regulates the development and maintenance of male characteristics such as facial and body hair. As we already went over the role testosterone plays in the male body, the name anabolic androgenic steroid makes perfect sense now. It's a steroid that controls male sex characteristics and promotes growth. Now, the media and the general public throws the term steroid around everywhere as if they all do the same. As we mentioned, they don't. However, even when we talk specifically about AAS, there are many different compounds and they all vary in their effect. When it comes to all these different AAS compounds, all of them are a derivative of testosterone, so they're all going to have similar mechanisms and effects. The largest effect, and one which most people are so concerned with, is they increase activation of androgen receptors. As a result, a muscle will experience growth through several mechanisms, including the increase of muscle protein synthesis, increase in the activation of satellite cells, and the mitigation of death of satellite cells. It also increases the production of erythropoietin. That's the PD that Lance Armstrong used to increase the production of red blood cells. While generally people think of testosterone as increasing muscle mass and strength, the production of erythropoietin means that testosterone can improve aerobic performance as well. Another important process is the aromatization of testosterone to estrogen. Aromatase is an enzyme that's responsible for turning testosterone into estrogen as a means to help regulate levels of the hormones cortisol and estrogen. However, an abnormal increase in estrogen can cause some serious side effects in men. In fact, this is the main cause for the most common concerns with AAS use. We'll get into this in a bit. However, there are some differences which are largely controlled by what's called the anabolic to androgenic ratio. This is a ratio that basically compares the anabolic effect of an AAS to the androgenic effect of an AAS. As the media lumps them all together, you would assume that all of them are going to do the same thing. However, that's like thinking all antibiotics do the same thing. Of course, they have similar functions, but different antibiotics have specific roles. In a similar way, the anabolic to androgenic ratio will dictate what compound is best for your needs, as well as what it does to the body. Compounds with a higher anabolic to androgenic ratio are more suitable for those looking to put on more muscle mass. On the contrary, compounds with a higher androgenic to anabolic ratio are better suited for those who want to increase strength and enhance physical performance. But the important question for this video is, do they work? Will injecting yourself with AAS increase your muscle mass? The short answer is yes, it will. It's almost as guaranteed as you can be. We'll get into exactly how much muscle you can put on later, but we want to ask, if it works well, why isn't everyone doing it? Because everything comes at a cost. Abuse of AAS can cause many detrimental effects to your health. Some are minor and transient, resolving themselves upon cessation of use. However, some are serious and chronic, which cause major issues, including death. Not good. This is important to know so you can decide if the muscle growth is worth the risk. We're now going to go through some of the more common side effects you may experience, the first being increased acne. While commonly reported by AAS users, researchers aren't exactly sure why use increases acne. One of the more probable causes is an increase in an oily wax known as sebum. Normal production of sebum is actually a good thing as it keeps the skin moist and can protect the skin. However, an increase in its production can clog pores and act as food for bacteria. A landmark study from 2021 determined that approximately 28% of AAS users experienced clinical acne. The degree of acne varied widely, which is probably determined by genetics. Therefore, if you're prone to acne, there's a relatively good chance you will experience acne. It may even be to the point that you won't even want to show off your muscles. Another huge concern for men is the expedition of male pattern baldness. Male pattern baldness, baldness specifically caused by androgen properties, was discovered in the 1940s when a man named James Hamilton discovered that men who had been castrated did not experience baldness unless they were given testosterone. In the same 2021 study, usage of AAS resulted in an increase of male pattern baldness in 12% of users. It's believed that those already prone to baldness will experience a great amount. This next one is a major concern, and often part of a joke concerning use of AAS, gynecomastia, or the growth of breast tissue on men. We need to be clear that this is not just the collection of excess fat on men on their chest area, rather it's actual growth on the glandular tissue of the chest. Many don't realize this gynecomastia is actually somewhat common to a small extent in many men. One study estimated that 40.5% of men aged 18 to 26 had detectable gynecomastia, while another study estimated that 36% of men aged 18 to 56 had detectable levels. However, the amount was still small. That's not always so with the improper use of AAS, as it can definitely cause this to increase and become quite noticeable. If you have ever seen bodybuilders with their shirts off, you may have noticed some who have extra puffy nipples. That's it. That's gynecomastia. In the same 2021 study, 19% of the men developed gynecomastia. The majority of the men had what's called grade 1, which is described as having a noticeable tissue group at the nipple causing it to become puffy. However, one man eventually developed grade 3, which is described as highly noticeable breast enlargement with a lot of excess skin and can actually resemble a female breast. Remember when we told you about the aromatization of testosterone into estrogen? That's what causes this. Depending on the severity, this can usually be reversed if caught early enough. However, results can vary greatly depending on how sensitive an individual is. Now, a more serious side effect of taking AAS is it will shut down the production of your naturally produced testosterone. When a man takes in a large amount of exogenous steroids, the body will think that it has a sufficient amount of testosterone and stop natural production, which occurs in the Leydig cells of the testes. As a result of the testicles preventing natural production, the testes will lose shape and become smaller and less firm. More importantly, men's sperm production is also suppressed, decreasing the quality of their sperm. Ultimately, it leads to them becoming infertile. This infertility exists during their cycle, but will also persist well after the men stop usage. The severity of this can vary greatly depending on the exact compound used, dosing, and length of use. To try and reverse this, traditionally men will perform what's called a PCT, or post-cycle therapy, after usage. Various drugs will be used, with two known as clomiphene citrate and human chorionic gonadotropin being the most popular. The main goal of these is to kickstart normal semen production again. In the past, this was believed to be sufficient to bring a man's normal production back up to normal levels. That's assuming the individual didn't take an egregious amount. However, newer research is showing this isn't the case. Research from 2023 analyzed a group of men who used AAS and the existence of azoospermia, the technical term for having no semen in your sperm. 23 men analyzed had azoospermia before they started their treatment, which consisted of clomiphene citrate and human chorionic gonadotropin. Keep in mind that the average length of treatment was 5 months. That should be plenty of time to get your testes back to normal levels. However, of those 23, only one was able to achieve this. Of the remaining men, 5 still experienced azoospermia, and the others only saw minimal to moderate improvements. When it comes to actual pregnancy, only 9 were able to have a successful pregnancy. That's just 40%. We do need to make it clear that these numbers are very high to what other papers suggest. For example, another large review suggests that the majority of men should see their levels return to baseline. How this is assuming that use is less than 4 years long. However, as the first review we mentioned used therapy for 5 months, this review suggests it probably takes significantly longer than that, anywhere from 1 to 3 years. Further, they also conclude that it reduces sperm health. In fact, different compounds have even been used in men as a form of contraception. In these men, 95% have seen their sperm production increased back to normal levels, but not until after 12 to 16 months of therapy. We do need to point out that one of the problems with getting exact numbers concerning AAS use and effect. As AAS UC is illegal, researchers aren't able to conduct proper research, so they rely on questionnaires, so little is controlled. Everything is self-reported, so there is a lot of room for error. Further, many of the deaths that have been associated with the use of AAS show that large amounts were used as well as the presence of many other hardcore drugs. Together with the self-reporting, this can make it difficult to get 100% hard evidence about what exactly is going on. However, with the rise of legal TRT, we'll likely be seeing more studies, at least with moderate doses. But how much muscle can you expect to grow? A study from 1996 set out to answer this question using 43 men split into 4 groups: placebo with no exercise, testosterone with no exercise, placebo plus exercise, and testosterone plus exercise. The amount of testosterone used was 600 milligrams of testosterone enanthate, and the exercise protocol used basic weightlifting exercises 3 days a week. After 10 weeks of training, the testosterone and training group put on an extra 13 pounds of muscle. But what's really interesting is that even the group that took testosterone but didn't exercise still saw significant increases in muscle mass and strength. Keep in mind that 600 milligrams of testosterone ethanate would be considered a moderate amount when used for athletic performance. If someone were to use dosing more similar to therapeutic testosterone replacement therapy, such as 100 milligrams a week, they may only gain. Well, actually, rather than guess, let's look at this other study from 2001. This study gave 61 various amounts of testosterone while following a controlled training program. The amounts administered were 25 milligrams, 50 milligrams, 125 milligrams, 300 milligrams, and 600 milligrams. After 10 weeks of training, the 25 milligrams actually lost some muscle mass as they actually shut off the natural production of testosterone, yet didn't replace it with a substantial amount. From there, the 50 milligrams group gained 1.32 pounds of muscle, the 125 milligrams group gained 7.48 pounds of muscle, the 300 milligrams group gained 11.44 pounds of muscle mass, and the 600 milligrams group gained 17.38 pounds of muscle mass. We could go on and on with studies on the use of testosterone or any AAS and muscle growth, but we'll save the time and just tell you, you will grow muscle. AAS are incredibly powerful compounds. As we saw in one study, individuals who didn't even work out still increased muscle mass. So the question about using AAS isn't about if you want to spend the money if it doesn't work. It will work, and many AAS are actually relatively cheap. The question is if it's worth the risk. This can depend greatly on the individual person, such as any type of health disorders, dosing, where they acquire the AAS, and if they use it under the supervision of a medical professional or at least get their blood tested. You could probably guess, but the safest way is to do it under the supervision of a trained professional with regular testing and a reasonable dose. In this manner, use is relatively safe. Plus, a user can see a substantial amount of growth on the lower range of dosing. Now, if you use by yourself with outside sources, well, the results can vary and you are putting yourself at a significantly greater risk.